So we can start.
Okay, good. Right.
So, so we will keep last 15 minutes to 20 minutes for questions, or should I continue in the previous way where we were allowing the participants to unmute and speak?
No, I think I have no issue if they stop me and ask okay. anything.
Okay, sir.
The only thing is this, you have to tell them that because when I am presenting, yes, I cannot see anything except my slide. So if they want to stop me, they have to speak.
Okay, sir.
Because if they raise hand, I cannot see it actually.
Okay, sir. Sir, are you able to see the chat box now?
Let me see. No, I have only one show participant.
Okay.
And and then some raise hand.
Reactions
and more actions in which there is no.
Okay, sir. Fine. Yeah. Sir, there is another option. If you want to see, then there is another option. You can go to the. Just share, sir. I'm sharing my screen.
Another. I will say. Simply, miss anybody who ask who want to ask anything. There is always a better option to speak out.
Okay, sir. So you may continue, sir.
Yeah. So that's not a big deal. Okay, and then you can stop me at any time. That's
yes,
not a big
okay,
deal.
Sir. Okay, sir. Anil sir is having some doubt. Anil sir, you can unmute and speak. Anil Kumar sir, you can unmute and speak. He had raised hand, but he is not unmuted.
Don't worry. If you want to ask anything, he can ask. So friends, let us now begin with our next session. And here, that's a very simple question, but you need to be confident that how the mathematical calculations are made in R. There are two things. One is the thing, it means as simple, just like a calculator, you can make such a calculation. And yes, R has a specific way when you are trying to deal with the data vectors. Right, so I will try to show you now in this coming slides. So one thing, I mean, say we already have understood that this sign, this is a prompt sign, right? So whatever you want to write, you can write it here. And you can see here in the screenshot also, this is here, right? Now, when you want to assign a value to a variable, you have here two options. Either you can use this sign, like less than and hash or equal to sign. Actually, to tell you the truth, when this S plus software was launched, then at that time, the prompt sign was given by actually this thing. That used to be the be in place of equal to sign in the S plus software. So since R was trying to copy each and everything from the S plus, so R also used the same symbol in place of equality sign. But I think it is now 5-6 years back only that R also provided this equality sign. So either you try to write down here X less than hyphen 20, or you try to write down here X equal to 20, that is going to be the same thing. And now I would request you here, I have tried to give you the screenshot also. So either you can be confident that after the question, you can mis-execute the same thing on the which are given in the slide, just copy and paste on the R console and you will get the same thing. Or else, parallelly, when I'm trying to explain you, you can keep on executing the same thing on the R console also, because these are very simple things. So yeah, means I believe that you can do it very easily. So R has two options. Either it can assign a value to a variable. For example, when I am writing x say equal to 20, that means the value 20 has been assigned to x. And when I am writing here y equal to x into 2, that means 2 into x is a new variable which is assigned to y. And when I am trying to write down here z is equal to x plus y, that means x and y both are variable, or in fact y is a function of a variable, but a variable is also assigned as a variable. So you can see here, if I try to take here x equal to 20, then y is equal to x into 2, the outcome comes out to be here 40, and then 20 plus 40 becomes here x plus y, which is here 60. So you can see here that is the same operation added as it happens in any software, in any calculator. Now, in case while doing any programming, if you want to comment a command, means you don't want it to be executed or you want to write a comment, the symbol here is hash. Right. For example, I will try to show you on the R console also that, for example, if you write down here x equal to 20, this will be treated as the value x, 20 has been assigned to x. But if you write the first letter as say hash, then this will only be a comment and nothing is going to actually change. So for example, these things are more important when we are trying to write down the program. For example, in a big program, I can write down, suppose I have used a variable say mu, so I can write down here mu is the mean and so on. So if I try to show you here on the R console itself, right, means if you try to say here z, now you can see here there is no here z, but if you see here x, there is here no x. So let me try to define here x is equal to say 20. So now you can see here there is here x equal to 20. Yeah, in case if you want to say any value, you simply have to write down the variable and press enter. Now I try to define here y is equal to suppose 3 multiplied by x. Right, now the value of y will become here 60, and now I can define here z is equal to x plus y. So you can see here this z becomes here 80. Now instead of here writing a small z, if you try to write down here capital Z, you will see here that this, it is saying that z is not found. Or if you try to write down here capital X, you can see here capital X is not found, whereas small x is available. So what is this happening? R is a case sensitive. So and capital X, they are different. Small y, capital Y are different. Small z and capital Z are different. Or even if I try to define here some variable here, mean is equal to, so suppose mean 1 is equal to 20. And if you try to see here, mean 1 will come out to be 20. But if I try to write down here capital MEAN mean 1, you will see here, it is saying that it is not found. So this is a case sensitive, small will remain as small and capital will remain as capital, number one. Now, in case if I try to see here, you can see here mean, if I write mean 1, this is here 20, but if I try to write down here, say hash mean 1 is equal to 30, you will see here, it will be just be treated as a comment. Right, still if you try to find out the value of here mean 1, this is here 20 because you had given it here, the value of mean 1. Because it is here comment, so it is not going to take here the value of here mean 1, or rather I had made here a space. I can make it here like this. Even then you can see here that mean 1 is 20. So this hash command is used as a only to comment something which you don't, on which you don't want to have the mathematical operation, as simple as that. If you don't want to execute, or if you want to ask anything, that please don't make any computation on this line. You have to simply write a hash sign and then it will work. And then as I said, this capital X equal to 20 and small x equal to 20, they are different. Well, in my slides, you will find one thing that sometime I have written less than hyphen and sometime equality sign. Well, I am using this S plus and R nearly since 1998, so this is more than now 22-23 years, and now 3-4 years back means I observed that now they are also using equality sign. So now it's a old habit that will die hard, but I will try my best to control it. But you please don't get confused. For you, equality sign and less than hyphen sign both are the same. Right, okay. Now I come to here, this command here, C. C mean concatenate, or in very simple language, I will write it. C combines the number which are written inside the parenthesis separated by comma. For example, now you can try yourself. If you simply write here on the R console y equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, it will give you here as an error. Right. Even if you try to write down here this parenthesis, even then it will give you an error. But when you try to write down here y is equal to C 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, it will give you the value like this. So C is a command to combine the individual values into a data vector. One thing I would like to clarify here, when I'm using the word vector, there are different types of vectors in the definition. When I am writing the data into in this format using the command C, this is called actually as a data vector. There is another vector which is coming from the vectors and matrices. There are another vectors which come from the vector calculus, etc. So here the data vector means vector. So just be careful. Now it is very simple for the addition, multiplication, division, subtraction. You simply have to use that usual command. 2 plus 3 will give you here the 5. 2 into 3 will go for the multiplication, 2 into 3. So these are very simple thing that you can see. It's not difficult. Right, similarly, if you want to subtract, yeah, this is 2 minus 3, division 3 upon 2. And yeah, this, if you want to make a more complicated expression, 2 into 3 minus 4 plus 5 divided by 6, then the word mass rule is followed here, just like any other calculator, any other programming language, any other simple mathematical rule. So that should not create any problem for you. Right. Well, in case if you want to write here the value like 2 is power of a cube, power 3, or say 2 cube, then I have a two option. Either I can write down here 2 hat 3 like this, or I can write down here 2 double star 3. So double star and hat, they are the same thing. Single star means multiplication, double hat means raised to the power of. Right, so these are the power operators. These are very simple thing. And then yeah, these power operators can be fraction also. For example, 2 is power of 0.5 is simply your here square root of 2. Right, and this is the same thing. Either you write 2 star star, and if you want to write down here 1 upon square root of 2, this is 2 hat, it is power of minus 0.5. So that will give you the same thing. So that is pretty straightforward. Means I would request you, yeah, these are very simple things. After the class, you can simply copy and paste and try to do those things. Now, more important part, which is very helpful in R, this begins now here. Now we are trying to see when we are trying to do such operations on a data vector, then what happens, right? So if you try to see here, means you have to actually understand how R is operating. When I try to write down here C, say 4 values 2, 3, 5, 7, and if I write down here hat 2, that means this hat operator is going to operate on 2, 3, 5, and 7 like this. 2 square, 3 square, 5 square, 7 square. And you can see here this value will come out to be 4, 9, 25, 49. And this here one, that is indicating the line number or the means, because there is only one value, so this is the first line in which this one is indicating that the first value here is 4, then second, third, fourth. If you have more values, that will come to the next line also. Right, okay. And right, more important part that you have to understand, means I would say first you try to concentrate on the explanation, and I will give you a minute, then you can try this thing, simply copy and paste, because the operation is more important than the calculation part. Now, if you try to see, I have taken here four numbers here, 2, 3, 5, 7. And then I have taken here another data vector of 2, 3. So now, and this is the power operation. So what will now happen, that you have to understand. This is here 2, this is here 3. So now these 2 and 3 will come here. This 2 and 3, this will come here. And it will put 2 square and 3 cube. Then it will come here once again, and it will make here 5 square and 7 cube. So this will be distributed according to the order of the numbers in the second vector. So now these are the four values which are obtained. 2 square is 4, 3 cube is 27, 5 square is 25, 7 cube is 343. Right, and you can see here, this is the same operation what you will get once you try to do it in the R console. Now, here if you try to see the total number of these elements in the second data vector here, they are exact multiple of the total number of numbers which are in the first data vector. First data vector has four numbers, 2, 3, 5, 7, and second data vector has two numbers. So this is the exact multiple, right? Now, what will really happen that if this is not exactly multiple, right? So that I will now try to show you, but before that, another example. Right, means if you have here six number, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and you have here means 2, 3, 4, 3 numbers in the second data vector, then the same process will happen, 2, 3, 4, then 2, 3, 4 here, like this thing. Right, so this will get distributed very easily. Now, here is the thing when you don't have the exact multiple. Suppose I try to take here in the first data vector, 2, 3, 5, 7, and then I try to take here 2, 3, 4. So now you will see here, this 2 will come here, 3 will come here, 4 will come here. But now there is, now this 2 will start coming here, 2, but now there is no space where this 3 and 4 can come. So it will give you the value here, 2 square, 4, 3 cube, 27, 5 is power of 4, 625, and 7 is square, 49. But after that, there is no number on which this 3 and 4 can be operated. So that is why it is giving you here a warning message. Do you know what is the meaning or what is the difference between warning and error? Many times means our parents give, okay, I will give you a slap. But rarely they slap us. They will simply, okay, if you do this time this mistake, I will throw you out of the house. But I don't think any parents are really going to throw their sons and daughters out of their home. So this is warning. But sometime when somebody does a mistake and the person is really thrown out of the house, then that will be an error. So similarly, in the R also, we have warnings and we have errors when we are trying to do something which R is not understanding, whether you have done it intentionally or unintentionally, it will say this is a warning. Warning means, okay, I am warning you, but I am doing your job. But when there's an error, that means you have not followed the rules and R cannot process it. So there you will get error. So that is what you have to keep in mind. So you can see here, you are getting here a warning, longer object length is not a multiple of shorted object length. That is, we have here four numbers in the first data vector and three in the second data vector. So exactly that is not the exact multiple. Right, so similarly, if you want to take here multiplication, if you try to multiply by here three, it means then each of the number two into three, three into three, five into three, seven into three, that will happen and you will get here an outcome. And similarly, if you try to take here two data vectors, I'm trying to take different examples, right? So first data vector has four number, 2, 3, 5, 7. Second data vector has -2, -3, -5, 8. So now once you try to multiply it here, this first value will be multiplied with the first value. Second value will be multiplied with the second value. Third value will be multiplied with the third value. And the fourth value will be multiplied with the fourth value. So this type of operation will be obtained here, right? And then you will get here the same outcome, which is obtained by simple multiplication. Right, okay. And similarly, if you try to take means another example, C2, 3, 5, 7 into C8, 9, where you have here four elements, here you have only two elements. So then 8 and 9, they will be multiplied first on 2 and 3. So 2 into 8, 3 into 9, then 5, 7 will be multiplied by 8 and 9. So 5 into 8 and 7 into 9. Right, and if you try to do it on the R console, this you get here the same outcome. Right, so you can see here it is not difficult, and the same concept is extended when you are trying to multiply the two data vectors. Here you have here four numbers, and here you have only here three numbers. So 8, 9, and 10, they will be multiplying on the first three data vectors, but the seventh has no number. So obviously, the R is telling you, okay, I have to means I have two more numbers left, which I want to multiply on some numbers, but they are not available. Please see whether you have made a mistake or there is what. Right, so this type of thing will happen here. Right, okay. So I hope it is not difficult. Means anybody who is facing any problem up to now, means can let me, and then I will proceed further. Means I will take your silence as there is no problem. But if you have any problem, you can just ask me. Right, okay. So now the same rule we are going to use for addition and subtraction. So if I try to take here a data vector 2, 3, 5, 7, and if I try to add a scalar here, so each of this number inside the data vector will be added with 10. Right. So this will become here 2 plus 10, 3 plus 10, 5 plus 10, 7 plus 10. Okay, so you get here an answer. And similarly, if you try to take here the means four values in first data vector, four values in seventh data vector, then the corresponding values at the respective position, they are going to be added. So first value 2 will be added with minus 2. Second value 3 will be added with minus 3. Third value 5 will be added with minus 5, and so on. So you can see here these things are happening. And similarly, if you try to take here four values in the first data vector, 2 in the second data vector, then 8 and 9 are going to be added here. So you get here this type of relation result. So that is pretty straightforward. Right, and similarly, if you try to take here four values in first data vector, 3 in second data vector, so that it is not an exact multiple, then the same thing will happen. This 8, 9, and 10, they will be operating over here. 2 plus 8, 3 plus 9, 5 plus 10, and then once again, this 8, 9, 10 will come here, 7 plus 8, but for 9 and 10, there is no number available, so it will give you here a warning message. Right. Okay, so now, now I will give you 1 minute of time, and I will request you that you please try to execute these commands on the R software. You simply have to, these are very simple thing, and I will wait for you if you have any questions or queries. Yeah, sir, if you have any question, you can simply ask.
Sir, good afternoon. Yeah, sir, that middle sign is plus. Yeah, 2 plus middle 8, 3 plus operation.
Pardon?
Middle, whatever data vectors, middle sign is plus. Addition is there. Addition.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, here, reverse is possible. Reverse means here. 2 is possible option for the reverse.
Means so, I'm not understanding what you mean by reverse.
So reverse means 2 + 8. Yeah, 2 + 8. First data vector, that element is 2. Second data vector, that element is 8. Yeah.
It's possible. You are doing something on your slide. I cannot see your slide. So if you just explain me your question, means I can understand it.
Yeah, exactly. Reverse data, that is 2, 3, 7, 2, 3, 5, 7 is reverse. Reverse is possible, that addition and subtraction.
Sir, are
it
you
means,
trying to
reverse
ask,
means subtraction?
End elements. Now here 2 is added to 10.
Actually, I cannot see anything.
Oh, sir, let me tell you. Sir, he's saying when you perform the operation, right now it is adding 2 + 8, means it is taking the first positional vectors.
Yeah.
He is asking whether it will be able to see take from the first list the first positional vector and from the second list the last positional vector. Right,
yes,
sir?
Yes. That is possible. And in order to do that thing, then you will have to write down the complete address.
Okay,
means
sir. Okay.
The name of the vector and the position. Then it can
also
be done.
Hmm. Okay, right. Sir. Okay.
I think it is important to come on the slide. Sorry, on the R console now.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you.
No, no, you have asked a wonderful question, actually, and I must show you here. Right, you see. Suppose I take here x equal to c, 1, 2, 3. Okay. Now I can see here x. But if I want to write down here x and this square bracket 2, and if you try to see here, this is giving me here the value 2. And similarly, if I try to write down here x3, this is giving me the third value. So this 3 is indicating the position of the vector. So if I try to take here, say x, or if I try to take here, say here another vector here, y is equal to c, 4, 5, 6, 4, 4, 5, suppose. Now, means I want to add here, say x plus y. So this will give me here 5, 6, 8. But if I try to write down here x1 plus, say here, y3.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you.
Right. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So now let me come back to my slides. Okay. So right. So now you see in the R software also there are some built-in functions also. Built-in function means there is a facility that you can compute couple of things directly. For example, maxima, minima, absolute, etc., etc. So let me try to give you a quick review that how you can do it. So suppose if you want to find out here the maximum, then the command here is max. So you have to, suppose you want to find out the maximum among 1.2, 3.4, minus 7.8. So you simply have to write down here max, which is the command. And then inside the parenthesis, you can write here these numbers. And you can see here 3.4 is the maximum value. So it will give you here an answer 3.4. Now I try to do one thing. Here, if you try to see, I have not written here the command C. And then I try to write down the same values with the command C. So you will see here that the answer in both the cases, this is coming out to be the same. But now here is a confusion that you can see here that when I am not writing here C, it is also giving me the correct answer. And when I am writing C, then it is also giving me the correct answer. But this is a very risky affair because sometime it may happen in some function, it will try to if you don't write here the C command, it will try to choose only the one first value here. So now there is a big confusion. And this confusion is coming because different people all over the world, they started contributing in the R software. And I have seen, means I know a couple of people, at least two people I know with whom I have met, who have written such basic programs in the base package. Right, so what was happening? That different people were writing different program. So it might be possible, I don't know, but that's my guess, that somebody has written the program which is valid only when you are trying to write down the C command, and somebody has written the program which does not use the C command. And in the beginning, they incorporated it, and after some time, they realized that this is going out of the way, so they added the C command also. So my suggestion to all of you is that don't try to experiment, but simply try to always use the command C, right? Because if you don't want to, because if you don't do it, and then after some time, when you are particularly writing a big program, suppose you write somewhere and it is giving you an output which is based only on the first value, you will never come to know that what is the mistake here. So better option is this, always use the C command. Okay, similarly, if you want to know here the minimum, means again the same thing, same pattern here. You just write to write down the numbers inside the parentheses with C, without C, both are possible. Right, similarly, there is a long list here that there are different functions that you can split here. For example, if you want to know the absolute square root function, round, floor, ceiling, etc., everything is possible. I will just try to show you here a couple of examples: sum, product, log, trigonometric function, etc. Right. So this is, for example, if you want to write down here absolute value of -4, this is a single value, so you don't need the C command. So this will come out to be here 4. And if you try to take here C, -1, -2, -3, 4, 5, you can see here, this function is going to operate on each of this value. Absolute value of -1 is 1, absolute value of -2 is 2, absolute value of -3 is 3, and absolute value of 4 and 5 are 4 and 5. So that is going to operate on each of the value. Similarly, if you try to take it here, square root of, say, 4, so square root of 4 is going to be, say, here 2. And similarly, if you try to take the square root of a data vector, then the square root function is going to operate on each of this element, right? And similarly, if you try to use here the function here sum, you can see here sum of C, 2, 3, 5, 7. Now I am giving you an exercise. Try to use this sum command with and without C and try to see the difference. So once I am using the sum command with the sum C, this is going to 2 plus 3 plus 5 plus 7. If I use the product command here, then the command is PROD and it is going to give us the 2 into 3 into 5 into 7. Right. And similarly, if you want to use here the round function of 1.23 is 1, round function of 1.83 is 2, and so on. Right. So I would say, I will give you here 1 minute and I will request you that you please try to experiment some of these command according to your wish.
Dr. Bhuvneshwari, you are allowed to unmute.
Yeah. So we get the same answer with and without C also. So what is the significance?
Please say again.
So we get the same answer when we are doing the sum with and without C.
Yeah. So in fact, let me try to see. Now, in case if you try to find out here mean of say 2, 3.
Ma'am,
I can share my slide and can show you here.
Ma'am is saying that if she's not using C word, means
wait, I will just show you.
And under bracket she's giving the values, then also she's getting the same result, then what is the significance of using C?
Yeah, that is exactly what I explained you. I will explain you again. Kushi, I will take here mean of here, say two numbers, two and three. What is the arithmetic mean of 2 and 3? 2 plus 3, that is 5 divided by 2, 2.5. But if you try to see here, the answer here is 2. But on the other hand, if you try to write down here mean of C, 2, 3, this will come out to be here 2.5. Whereas in the case of here sum, 2, 3, that will give you the 5. Sum of C, 2, 3, that will give you the answer 5. Now, in case if you try to define the mean as the sum of all the observation divided by 2, you can see here sum of 2, 3 divided by 2. This will come out to be here 2.5, whereas the 2 by 3, this will come out to be 2. So that is why it is important, as a rule, you must always use C. Is otherwise the miss, I'm telling you from my experience, the type of problem which it will make, that will practically be impossible for you and me to identify, and you will never come to know, because our usual the programs, real programs, they have 100 lines, 1000 lines and so on, and you cannot just check the intermediate. Right, so let us try to now take some more example. You see, whenever you are trying to use any programming language, you have to first inform the language whether your variables are numeric, they are character, or they are what. So similarly, in the R programming also, we have the command here mode. Don't get confused with the mode as mean median mode. Because for mean, we have mean, for median, we have median, but for mode, we don't have mode. Mode is something like what we used to study in our childhood, a chapter like as mode of transportation. Right, so this mode of transportation means what are the different ways of transportation. So this is that mode. So if I try to take here a number here, say x equal to 6, and if you try to find out here the mode, mode of x, that mode of x means you write mode and inside the parenthesis you write here x. So you will see the answer will come out to be here numeric. Right, and similarly, if you try to take here say this data vector here, say c1 2 3 4, and if you try to define here new variable x1 say square, this will again come out to be here like here this 1 4 9 6. But in case if you try to see its a mode, that will come out to be means once again numeric. And similarly, if you try to take here any variable here, as I can explain you, say here apple is a character. So always remember one thing, because I will tell you later on, that whenever you are trying to write down a character, you have to write it only inside the double quotes. Or I will say in the reverse way, whatever you are writing inside the double quotes, the R will always take it as character. So if you wish, you can try, just try to write down x equal to this apple inside the double quote and try to find out the mode of x. Right, and now we try to give you to have a quick idea about the matrices. Matrix, I believe that you all know, because if you don't know, we have no time here to understand the matrix theory, but in general I can see here x is matrix is only the arrangement of this numbers or say alphabets in rows and columns, so that every number has got an address. And suppose if I say here I have here a matrix like here x like this, then if I want to call the value in the third row and the second column, then in the then we usually be indicated by x 3, 2 inside the parenthesis or a square bracket or curly bracket depending on the programming language. So that will give you the particular value. So I will very quickly try to show you here the different or the important aspect of the matrix theory. And believe me, whatever examples I have taken here, as I said. Okay, before going further, let me ask you one thing. Up to now, is there any command or any place where you are feeling that it is difficult? Means if you are feeling, if your answer is say yes, otherwise you can remain silent. Good. Sometimes silence is also a good news.
Can this answer be can we answer this question tomorrow so that we can also practice on?
You can answer it at any time up to the next 3 days.
Thank you.
Next 3 days I have booked booked me for you guys. After that there is somebody else waiting for me because for 3 days I am whole day I am with you, so all my jobs and pending assignments I will have to complete. Right. So
a little bit slow, sir.
Pardon?
Little bit slow in presenting.
Okay. Right. So now if you try to see, yes, sir, if I am trying to write down here a matrix, so then you know that matrix has to be written in a particular way. So the one thing what you have to understand that the command to write down here the matrix is simply matrix matrix. And whenever you are trying to define a matrix, then there are certain parameters which have to be defined. How many rows are there, how many columns are there, and what are the data values. So for that we have here the option that we write here the matrix, and inside the parentheses we define the number of rows by the parameter n row. N row equal to whatever you want to say, 4.
Just hold on, I'm trying to reconnect, sir. He has exit. Maybe there is some network issue at his end. Am I audible?
Yes, madam. Yes.
Yes, sir. Yes, I'm trying to connect him again.
Okay, madam. Okay.
Maybe there is some network issue at his end. Abhinav? Please mute yourself. All of you are requested to mute. Abhinav, there is some disturbance from your end.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Meri awaaz aa rahi hai, Abhinav?
Yes, ma'am, aa rahi
hai. Acha. आपके एंड में कुछ प्रॉब्लम है? ये मिस डॉक्टर महेंद्रन इज हैविंग सम प्रॉब्लम. मैं जरा शलभ सर को फोन करूं. Please hold on everyone, sir is trying to reconnect. There is a network issue at sir's end. Was sir explaining matrices?
which I had the four rows and two columns, and I had considered the data 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And this matrix was coming out to be like this. So I will try to continue with the same matrix that we had constructed in the last lecture. And then we try to see that what are the different aspects of this matrix that can be revealed by our commands. For example, there is a command DIM, which means dimension. This dimension command helps us in getting the dimension of a matrix. So the syntax is like this, that first you write DIM, dim, and inside the bracket you have to write the name of the variable that is containing the matrix. For example, in this case, we have seen that our matrix here is, for example, is of order 4 by 2. So as soon as I say here dimension of X, it gives me 4, 2. This means 4 by 2, there are 4 rows and 2 columns. Now, in case if I want to know what is the number of rows in a matrix, then the command is nrow, that is the number of rows. And the syntax is N-R-O-W, and inside the bracket you have to write down the variable name that is containing the matrix. So here we have seen that there are 4 rows. So as soon as you try to do here nrow X, the quickest will give you an answer 4. Similarly, the number of columns of a matrix can be determined by the command NCOL. That means the number of columns, and inside the bracket you have to give the variable that is containing the matrix. So for example, here in this case, there are 2 number of columns. So as soon as you write NCOL and inside the bracket X, it will give you an answer 2, which is the number of columns. And here you can see that is the same thing I have done here, that I have given the screenshot. So if you want to try yourself, you can also try these commands on your computer. Okay. Similarly, there is another command that we had discussed earlier also, but just for the sake of quick revision, I will try to show you here. This is mode of X. Mode of X means this provides us the information that what type of variable it is and what type of storage mode of an object is contained in that variable name. For example, this can be a numerical value, this can be a logical value, and so on. So for example, here we have seen that in our matrix X, this is a 4 by 2 matrix containing some numbers from 1 to 8. So this is a numerical value. So as soon as I say here mode of X, mode, and inside the bracket I have to write the variable name that is containing the matrix, then it gives me an answer numeric. That means all the values contained in the matrix are numeric. They have a numeric character. And similarly, at its command, this provides some other type of information about the attributes of an object which are controlled by that matrix. For example, in double, X is 4 by 2.
Welcome back, sir.
Thank you, Radha. I think there was some problem in the internet at my home. So, yeah.
Yes. So, you have come to your office.
Yeah. Sorry for this.
In the meantime, I just shared your recorded lecture I had on matrix. So, I just started with that.
So, in fact, when I opened it, I got badly confused that what's really happening.
I am having all your recordings of NPTEL, sir.
I see.
So I just shared that, means from where you had dropped, I picked up from there itself.
I see.
Okay.
Right, sir. So I think now we can start, we can
yes.
Hear. Right, so yes, so if you try to see here, we have command here, a matrix, and then we have to specify the number of rows, number of columns, and the data. The more important part here is that you need to understand what's really happening and how are you going to give us such information. So if you try to see here in a matrix, the key ingredients are the total number of rows, total number of columns, and the data what you want to enter. So the total number of rows here are here 4, suppose I want to give, total number of columns is 2, so I want to have here a matrix of 4 by 2. 4 by 2 means the total number of entries are going to be 4 to the 8. So I try to take here the number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Now, you have to observe one thing which I'm going to show you in this command and in the next command, that when you are writing here matrix and row and call specified, and whatever the data you want to enter, that can take different formats. I have taken here a very simple format for the sake of understanding, 1 to 8. Now, if you try to see, if you try to execute it on the R console, it will come out to be like this, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then 5, then 6, then 7, and then 8. Right, so this is the way in which the data is going to enter into a 4 by 2 matrix. But there can be another thing, you want to enter the data in row wise. Here the data is going column wise, like this, then this, then this, then this, and so on. But suppose you want to make it row wise, like as this, 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 like this. So what I have to do here, that I have to give here a command here, an option here, parameter, by row is equal to true. This will give you the data entry by row. As the name suggests, by row, that means the data has to enter by row wise. And this capital T-R-U-E, this is a logical operator. True means true, and similarly false means false. So in case if you try to write down here by row equal to true in the same command here, then you can see the data will come out to be 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 4, 4 to 5, 5 to 6, 6 to 7, and 7 to 8. Right, whereas if you don't write the say here by row equal to true, as in the earlier command, then by row equal to false is actually silent, and this data will enter like here, like this, in this particular way. So this is what you have to always keep in mind when you are trying to enter the data. And similarly, if you want to access any particular value in the data, then the command is very simple. Try to write down the matrix, the row and the column position. So you can see here that in the third row, first, second, and third row, second column. So the value here is 7. So if you want to access the seventh value, you can simply write down here x 3, 2. And you see, it is very easy to understand it. You simply try to see here, this here 3, this is at the first position, and 2 is here at the second position, and you can get it here. Right, okay. So this is how you can get this data. And similarly, if you suppose you get some unknown matrix in which you don't know what are the specifications, then you can use here a command here, dim. DIM, DIM is dimension. So dimension of X is going to say here, say for example, in this case, this is a 4 by 2 matrix, so it is going to give you here 4 and 2. And N row X, that is the number of rows you want to know in a matrix, that is by N row, this command. And similarly here, N call command, that will give you the number of columns. So that you can see here, they are coming out to be here 4 and 2, right? But I have given you very elementary introduction because of the given time available to me. But if you try to look into the help of this matrix, that you can see there are many information, many pieces of information which is there, right? So means I would say simply, you don't worry at this time, but later on, whenever you want to use it, first have a look on these details. Right, this is, I have simply copied and pasted on the slide from the help available on the matrix, and that you can obtain directly from your means RStudio also. Right, so I try to show you now here some important, or say some very common operations which you may need during your this analysis. So you see, if you try to if you want to have a matrix where all the elements are the same, they are constant, suppose I want to have here the value equal to 2. Right, so I can suppose I want to have here a matrix of say 4 rows and 2 columns. So I can write down here n row equal to 4 and col equal to 2. And then I simply have to give it data is equal to true 2. So you can see here this is a 4 by 2 matrix where all the data values are 2. So that will give you an idea that how to generate a matrix in which all the values are constant. Right. Similarly, if you want to generate a diagonal matrix we know in which all the elements in the diagonals are non-zero, means all of them are not zero, and the off-diagonal elements are always zero. For example, identity matrix. So identity matrix, if you want to write, you have to use either command DIAG1, and diagonal matrix is a square matrix, so n row equal to 2 and col equal to 2. So this will give you here a 2 by 2 identity matrix. And similarly, if you want to have different terms on the diagonal, like as 1, 2, 3, then in that case, let's try, replace this one by say C1, 2, 3. That's all. Right, so this is how you can do this job. Okay. Now, similarly, the same thing what you did, means I will try to show you it in other slides, that you have generated the data 1, 2, 3, 4, up to 8. The same data set can be generated by this command here, 1:8. That is the command to generate a sequence beginning from 1 to 8. So even if you want to give this number here, you can also give. This number I'm telling you because after some slides, I am trying to give you here a couple of things to show you that how you can generate different types of data, how you can enter different types of data values. Right. So if you try to take here, still you will get here the same command here. No issues. And similarly, if you want to know the transpose of a matrix. Transpose of a matrix means the rows become columns and columns become rows, then the command here is T. So if you try to simply write down here T inside the parenthesis here X, this will be here like this. Right, so you can see here the same matrix, this is now become a 2x4 matrix. Right, and now about the, that means addition, division, subtraction, addition, subtraction, multiplication and inverse. In a matrix, how to get it done. So simple rule of mathematics, they are going to be followed. Means you cannot say that if there are two matrices, one is of order 3x3 and another of order 4x4, then they can be added or they can be multiplied. Whatever are the rules of matrix theory in mathematics, they have to be followed here without any problem. Right, okay, so if you try to multiply a matrix by scalar quantity 4, that means every element is going to be multiplied by that constant. So this will be, so you can see here that in the same matrix which you have taken here X, right, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, that is going to be here, means every number is multiplied by here 4, 4, 8, 12, 16 and so on. So multiplication of a constant by a scalar, that is controlled by the simple mathematical operator star. Now, in case if you want to make the matrix multiplication, that means two matrices are going to be multiplied. So we know if I have here two matrices A and B, they are going to be multiplied only when the number of columns in the first matrix, they are same as the number of rows in the second matrix, so that this N and N should be the same. So if you take any such two matrices, and then if you try to multiply them, then you have to use the operator percentage star percentage. That is the difference. In many software, yeah, the notation for this matrix multiplication as a scalar multiplication, they are the same. But here, they are going to be different, right? So now you can see here trace of X. This was a matrix of order 2x4. So trace of X is here 2x4 and X is here 4x2. So 4 and 4 are common here. So this is going to be a 2x2 matrix, you can see here. So the way the matrix multiplication is done, the same rule is being followed here also without any problem. Right. And there is in statistics there is a very popular term like as here x transpose x that we use many times. So in order to compute such a matrix, that means transpose of x into x, what I have shown you here, the same thing also can be done by the operator here, cross prod, CROSSPR, cross product of the matrix. That means the transpose of matrix into the matrix itself. Right. The only thing is this, you can ask me what is the difference between cross product and then this simple multiplication. Because you see in this software, the matrix operation, matrix multiplication, inverse, etc., they are based on the some algorithm. So in this case, the algorithms is faster in computing this cross product compared to the earlier one. That is the main difference between the two. And similarly, if you want to add two matrices here, you simply have to use the plus operator. If you want to subtract two matrices, you have to use the minus operator. And so these are very simple things. After this, I will give you a minute so that you can quickly revise it. Now I am going to give you here something which you have to understand very carefully. This is confusing. Suppose I try to create here a matrix 5x3, is 5 rows, 3 columns, by row equal to 2, and data is equal to 1 to 15 numbers. So you can see here, this is the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on. This is our matrix. Now, I want to call here the third row and third column, or say third row or second column, or say any particular row or any particular column. So how to get it done? So now the rule is very simple here. You try to write down here the matrix, and then suppose if you want to call the suppose third row, you simply write down here x3 and comma and leave this blank, as you can see here, and you will get here the number 789. And similarly, if you want to have here the second column, which is this one, then you have to simply write here x square bracket and then blank space and then comma and then 2, and this will give you here 2, 5, 8, 11, 14. Right. So this is how you can call a row or call a vector. Now, similarly, you can call actually any submatrix from this matrix. For example, if I want to have a submatrix from here in which I want to take the fourth and fifth rows, sorry, columns and fourth and fifth rows and second and third column. So this is going to be a this part, because this is your here. Wait, let me try to clear the screen so that I can. So suppose I want to mimic it here, say here, this submatrix, fourth and fifth rows and second and third column. So this is the submatrix here, which I want. So you can see here, I can give here a command x 4, 2, 5, 4, 5, that means 4, 5 and 2, 3, that means 2, 3. Also you can give here C4, 5, C2, 3 also like this. You can actually try and you will get here this matrix. And similarly, if you want to obtain the elements of any other row or any other column also, that also you can do here very easily without any problem. You simply have to give here those row numbers and column numbers in this same matrix. Now I come to another aspect where I would like to confuse you, and then you have to see how you can get away. If you try to observe here on this outcome, right, both are, and suppose if I hide this thing, and suppose by looking at this outcome, suppose you want to know whether this is the outcome of a row or a column, can you identify it? The answer is no. Because if you try to see here, it is not, this outcome is not showing anything here, whether this is row or column. But unless and until you know the command, you cannot know it. So there you have to be careful, because in some software, in some programming language, it is clear.
Right.
And similarly, if you want to find out the inverse of a matrix, the command here is simply here, solve. Right, if you try to take any matrix, I have just taken any possibly definite arbitrary matrix, and this is here like this, and if I simply say here solve y, is I get this answer, no issues. So solve is going to give you only an answer. So now I will give you here 1 minute or 2 minutes of time, and I would request you that if you have any confusion, you ask, and you try to at least copy and paste couple of commands so that you gain some confidence. But definitely I would request you all that after the lecture, you try to at least quickly revise these things, whatever we have done today.
Adil sir, you can unmute yourself. He has some question, I think. Anuradha madam, wait.
Yes ma'am. I just wanted to ask, like if you want to find the inverse of a matrix, the matrix has to be a square matrix, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, yes. So in fact, yeah, that's what I said in the beginning itself, that whenever you are trying to do the matrix operation, all the rules of the matrix theory, they have to be satisfied. The matrix has to be square matrix, and the matrix has to be a positive definite matrix also, so that its eigenvalues are always greater than zero. Only then the inverse can be found, otherwise it will give you the matrix.
Okay, thanks.
Adil sir, you can unmute yourself. I can see your hand raised, so I have unmuted you.
That hand raise was by mistake. Okay.
Okay. Fine, sir. Fine, sir.
Right. So now let me continue here. And
there is one more query, sir. Sure. Satish sir, you can unmute. Satish sir, you can unmute. Maybe that is also by mistake.
Okay. So yeah, one thing I would be honest in accepting, that you see, that is the drawback in the online workshop, that I don't know where you are, who you are, and how is your speed. Means in the classroom, I can always control this thing, and that is the precise reason that in my physical workshop, usually I take not more than 20 to 25 students at a time, so that I can supervise them one-to-one. But anyway, that's the pandemic time, so whatever, as a human being, we are trying our best to deliver. You also try your best, and then we have to do something more so that there is no compromise on the quality of learning. I'm trying my best. But you can imagine how difficult it is. I am just sitting in a single room. If you don't believe, you can see that's my office, and so on. There is no one, and I am simply speaking like mats. Right. So, but anyway, I'm trying my best.
Is your dedication, sir, that you rushed to the office because you were having some problem at home. Means disaster management.
Yeah, Miss, I told you yesterday that there is always probability greater than zero. Believe me, it very rarely happens. In the last 17 years of my stay in the campus, this was the second time it happened. And by the time I reached, I think after 2 minutes, 3 minutes, I got a call from my wife that the internet is restored. But anyway, yeah, because actually the problem is this, because we have a internet at our home, which is provided by the institute. But nobody thought while delivering that everybody will be working only from home, and offices are completely blank. So the entire load is going on only a single line. So
yes,
that is the
agreed.
Problem. We know that is happening. But in any way, yeah. Okay, anyway, so let us come back to our business. Can you just give me 1 minute? I can bring some water. That is the advantage of staying at home.
Sir, sure, sir. Please, sir.
Yes, okay. So now we try to come on another aspect. Whenever you are doing anything, software, statistics, data science, whatever, you will always be getting the data in some file, which you have to read it from the file. And this data can be coming from say different ways. That can be a CSV file, tabular data file, or file from any other software. So in R, how to handle this thing and how you have to be careful that how are you going. So yeah, it means this I already have told you that how to set up that directory, right? So that is why it's no need. Yes, so now I'm going to show you here how to import CSV file, TXT file, and spreadsheet like as MS Excel file. Then for other type of file from different software like SPSS Minitab, yeah, there is a way you can do it. But before I do, I will try to show you it on the R console, but I would suggest you very strongly that you don't follow the R console, but you simply try to do it in the R Studio, which is very, very simple. But I personally feel that it is important for you to understand the basic and fundamental behind how this is happening. Right, so suppose, I can show you here, I have uploaded here a file on my home page, right? This is some data file. If you just try to click at this link which I have given here, you will see some file will get open. Right, now I want to read this file in an online mode. Right, and this is a tabular file. So okay, beforehand I'm telling you, but I will discuss it in detail. We have a command here, read.table, and I'm simply trying to say here this file equal to this one. Within double quotes I am writing the command to read the file, and I request you that you try to use this command. Just copy and paste your command on your R console, and then you will see this data file will come directly from my home page to your website. Means I can show you here. So at least at this moment you can see here there is no file like data mospi, but now I try to do it here and you can see here this is now here. And if you try to see here, I can I will just copy this address and I am putting it on my home page. You see here, this data is here. So the message what I want to give you here by this content is that you can read the data directly from the websites also, and this is the primary need of the data sites. Usually the data is entering directly from the customers, from the complainant, from the whatever you call, and you have to fetch the data in a real line, in a real time basis, and then you have to use your statistical tool, right? So anyway, so just try to mean, so actually I have not given you these files, but I have taken very simple example which I would request you to just create it, Actually, I have in my MS Excel, I have given you here the screenshot. You just try to create here a small file, and whose entries are first column entries are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Second column the entries are 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. Third column is 100, 200, 300, 400, 500. Right, and you try to save this file means anywhere in your working directory somewhere. Right. So I have given this file name here. I will be using here the screenshot, but you can do it directly on your laptop. So you try to create here a CSV file. I mean, you just have to open MS Excel, enter this value and save as example1.csv. In order to read the CSV file, the command here is read.csv, and inside the parenthesis within the double quotes, you have to give the file name. Right. So now if you try to click here, means what you will get here, this will be a file like this thing, and whatever I'm going to read it, I'm going to store it by a name data. Yes.
The example which you gave regarding read.table, you asked us to just copy the entire.
No. You just open your MS Excel.
I'm not talking of CSV, sir. I'm talking of read.table, the example you gave before that.
This one.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
So I was not, I'm getting error out here.
Means I have shown you online.
Yeah.
And I can show you here once again online. So you have to accept that is you are making some mistake somewhere. Right, I will just say here Control L, RM. Data MOSPI. So I have removed here. You can see here.
Your screen is not visible, sir. PPT is.
I see. Right. So we can see here, which I can say now simply here. Now we can see here there is no data MOSPI file. Now okay, I simply have copied the same command here and I executed it. And now if I try to show you here, this is the data file. I simply copied the command and pasted in the R console. And the same file, if you try to see here, which I was trying to show you here, it is on my use click here. That's my home page. And here, this is the file here. I can increase the font size.
The error right. I'm getting is error in file within brackets file comma double quotes RT. Cannot open the connection.
So that means you are not connected to internet.
So how come it is possible, sir? My Teams is working.
You see, in life, we can always make hundreds and thousands of mistakes, and nobody does it intentionally.
So that's why I'm asking you what mistake it could be like.
Yeah, I have. Means unless and until you show me your outcome, how I can say?
I don't have rights to share the screen.
Wait. I am showing the correct way, and means you can believe on me.
Ma'am, you have right now. I have made you presenter. You can share your screen.
Pardon?
So she can share. She can share now. I have made her presenter.
Yeah, there can be only one mistake. Either there is.
She's sharing.
I cannot see here anything because it's not actually complete. It is not even visible. Can you increase the font size?
Maximize the screen, madam. Maximize the screen.
Read table files. Wait. You have not put the bracket there. Just try to put one more bracket at the end. just try to put one more bracket at the end and then execute it. No, just repeat the command. Ha, put here. Why you just do it? Yes, I would say simply copy the command from there once again and then try to do it. No, not from there. Copy from the file. Okay, you don't worry. I will try to show you once again here. Yeah, can you not see the presentation?
It's loading, sir.
I'm simply copying it here before you.
From your PPT, I'm not able to copy, sir. No, that's why.
So, content has been sent on group. You please download the content.
Okay, I'll do that. Okay.
I'm asking you from the same file from where you are working.
I'm seeing your PPT and I'm just typing it out from
she's
there.
She's typing. Okay.
I know what is the difference. The problem is this. I am working on PPT. So here there is a break HO after this.
Yeah.
Right. So
yeah.
It is in continuation. You are doing it from the PDF file. So there is a break at HO after HO.
Okay. So that is whole data.
Right. So in fact, I had given you only a help that you copy. Otherwise, you simply type it independently and do it.
So I have typed it independently. I've not copied.
So how? Then I would say that means that type it without any mistake.
Okay, I'll just try it once again. No issues. You carry forward.
Thank you. You can share it on the R console. Wait. Right. You see, I'm simply making here control V, or I can say here before you paste. That's all. I'm entering it here and it is coming.
Sir, right. There are some so more there queries. There are some more queries. Banu Virana, sir.
I would say that is why I am showing you online. So that if there is a mistake, you have to simply find it out where you are trying to make the mistake.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And then secondly, I mean, my idea is simply here to tell you that yes, it is possible to read the data from an Excel file, from the software file, as well as directly from the internet. Right? Yes. Yes, please ask. Hello.
Hello, namaskar.
Kindly ask
sir, in my case, it is working the same command. I have run that command. It is like the data file is saved in the global environment.
Yeah. It will happen. You see, these are very common issues in the programming that when you try to do it, these small things will actually always happen. So for that, instead of asking me to find out the mistake, this comma and this full stop, means I would suggest that if you struggle, then you will actually learn more. That is basic fundamental of the programming that, for example, if somebody has typed O in place of zero, by looking at your screen, I cannot find it out. But the more simplest thing, yes, before coming to the tour workshop, I have tried this and it was working. So I have taken this command over here. So I'm sure that this is working. So, and once it is working on my laptop, what can be a reason that it is not working in your laptop? So be confident, right? I will say simply, just be confident. These things will surely work. Right, okay. So now let me come back to my slides. Right, so what I want to show you here, if you have created this Excel file in your laptop, and now if you try to read it here, I will show you here one thing. Whatever is the outcome of this file, which you have done by reading from this Excel file, this is here in this command data. And now if you try to see the data, some values are coming here, X1, X10, X100, and the values are starting from here 2, 3, 4, 5, not from 1, 2, 3, 4. So the question is this, why this is happening and how this problem can be resolved, because you wanted to read the data exactly in the same way as you want to enter it. So here you can see that the first row of the data is not read. The reason is that whenever you are trying to read a table, there is always the first row that can be used as a header also. So once you are trying to call a file in the R software, you have to additionally inform whether there is a header in the data file or not. Right. So now in case if you try to say, for example, in this case, there is no header in the data. You can see here, there is no header, only here the values. So you have to write down here, header is equal to false. And false is a logical word, that is a reserved word, which has to be written in the capital letters always. Right, now once you try to write down the same command with here, with an additional argument here, header is equal to false, then you will see here, this data is the same as the data which is here. Right, so whenever you are trying to, and this concept is true for all, whether this is a CSV file, text file, Excel file, whatever it is, that will always be there. So this is what you have to keep in mind when you are trying to read a CSV file using the command read.csv. Right, and if you don't have the header, you can simply use it here, header equal to false. If there is a header, you try to use here, header is equal to true. But now you can see here one thing. It has given a new name to its variable. V1, V2, V3, these are the default name which are given by the R software. So you don't want these names. You want to change these names. So for that, suppose you want to rename them as column 1, column 2, column 3. So for that, my command here is, you simply try to use here the command names, and you try to write down the data, object which you have read, because this data is the object which you have read here. Try to give it here a name, like as column 1, column 2, column 3, or whatever you want within the double quotes with this C command. And as soon as you enter it, now you can see here, your new name becomes here, means column 1, column 2, column 3, and with the same data set. So this is how you can handle these things, right? And definitely, if you ask me to give a lecture only on how to handle the files in the data set and try to do the same operation what we do in the MS Excel or any Excel sheet, it will take complete 3 to 4 days to understand all the operations. But the fact is, but the moral of the story and the bottom line is this: whatever operations you can do in any data file, either in Excel or TXT or whatever you want, the same thing can be done in the R software also without any problem. So yeah, and suppose if you want to change only the particular name, suppose you want to change this column 2 as, say here, state. So for that, you simply have to write down here names and the data, and then with this square bracket, because square bracket means you are trying to specify a particular position. So the second position in the names of data, you want to write down here, say state. So try to input the values exactly in the same way as you did earlier. Now in the new one, you will get here the name as state. Right, so these are different what you can do. And these are the screenshots, so you can be confident that when you are doing it yourself, you also get the same outcome. Right. And yeah, if you want to say, suppose change the name of the second and third column, so you can use here C23 in place of C2 only and give here two names. So now you can see here the state one and state two will happen here. So these are different ways of giving the name to the file. I thought that it is important because whenever you get the file, usually the names are different and the way you want to handle it, particularly in the data science, right? So this is for the for a simple CSV file. You know that if you have ever imported a file in the MS Excel, if from a text data set, it always give you an option and it asks that whether you separated is comma, full stop, or the delimiter is what, space or comma, etc., etc. So similarly, in the R also, if you are getting a file which has a tab as a delimiter or a space as a delimiter, in that case, you need to add here one more parameter while reading the file. For example, if the file is tab delimited, tab means you try to enter the data after the tab, then you have to use this option here, sep is equal to backslash T within double quotes, and your command will become the same command, but now this sep will be added here. And there is here a space delimited means your data is separated by space, then your sep is going to be simply a blank space. Yeah, just a blank space within the double quotes, and then you can read the file. So you can see here whatever operations you can do in the MS Excel to read the file, the same thing can be done here also. And similarly, when you are trying to read a tabular data file, you know what is the meaning of a tabular data file? That means every row there is a data set, and means every variable has got the same number of data set. For example, if you try to write down in the columns the marks of the student physics, chemistry, maths, and on the rows is to number one, is to number two, is to number three. So that means every student has got three types of marks, physics, chemistry, maths. So every row will have the same number of elements, and every column will also have the same number of elements. That is the structure of the tabular data, right? So this tabular data can be read in the R software using the command here, read.table. You can see now, once you have understood how you can read the CSV file, the same thing will go either you have a tabular data or a text data. You simply have to use the suitable command. So read.table, after that header, etc., etc., whatever you have studied, they will go exactly in the same way. Right, for example, if I try to take the same data set, but I try to now save it as an example 3.txt, where the separator here is, say a blank space, right? Means you, what I have done here, that I simply have typed the data in the notepad, like a 10, say 1, 10, 100, 2, 20, 200, and I have given only a blank space in between, you can see here, like this, and I have called this data, and I want to read it, that txt file. So now you can see here this example 3.txt, this is the notepad file, and then I have given here the separator is equal to blank space, this thing. So now you can see here this data will come over here. Now you have here v1, v2, v3 here, then now you can change the name, etc., etc. And now when you are trying to read the data from different types of file, the special packages to read CSV and TXT file, they are built in the base package, but for other types of file, you need to install a different package. So for example, if you want to read the MS Excel file, then there is a special package which is called, as I said, read Excel. Means you need to first install this package. So either you try to write down, this install dot packages read Excel, and then you have to use the command library, or you simply go to your RStudio and simply try to install or load the package read Excel. After that, you can do it. And then the command here is read underscore Excel, and then whatever is the file name that you have to give here. But a more simpler option is this. A simpler option is that you simply go to RStudio and then try to use the command there. Import a data set that I shown you in the last lecture, and you simply open the file. The RStudio will automatically load the package and it will open the file, right? So you don't have to worry for those things. And yes, in case if you want to use here a particular, because in the Excel file means one Excel file can have different sheets of data. So those sheets can be defined by number or they can be given a name. So in case if you want to read a particular sheet of the Excel file, then you have to use the command here. Sheet is equal to, say, within double quotes, you have to simply write here SHEET sheet 3. That's all. And it will read the third sheet of your Excel file. Or if you have given a name, then instead of writing a sheet 3, you just write there the name and that file will be opened.
Right. Sir, can I ask? Pardon? Sir, can I ask something?
Yeah, sure.
Sir, I created a file in Excel and I stored that file in desktop. Now it's a CSV file. So now if I'm giving that command, data is equals to read.csv and in brackets book1.csv. So in that case, like it's not retrieving the file because I think it is not able to read from the desktop.
Yes, yes, because actually first you have to change your working directory.
Okay, so sir, what should I do for that?
You see, more simple option is that either you try to write down the address of the desktop and you copy there, or a more simple will be try to create that file on any directory on the C drive. So it is easier for you to type that C:// you can write R course.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
Means here there is no problem. Means if you can copy the address of your desktop.
Yes, sir.
In terms of C:// document/data...
then right, sir.
It will work. Means otherwise you simply create a folder on your C drive and yes, give sir. The address simply, which will have no chance of mistake.
Yeah. Got it, sir. Thank you very much.
Or otherwise, what you can do, you can simply open the RStudio.
Yes.
And come to desktop and open it. As simple as that.
Okay. Right.
So same question I do have. I have created a file in R course directory in C drive as you have done in your examples. And I have used set wd command to just set the working directory. And thereafter I have given read.csv command and within brackets I have written example1.csv. which I have created as you shown had shown in your example, but I am again having an error in that.
That cannot happen, okay? Means I can miss.
It happens.
I think you see, I am sure that you might be making some mistakes somewhere in typing. Is otherwise there is no reason actually. Right? Okay. You do one thing. You come to RStudio.
Okay.
I'm just changing. You come here to RStudio and simply come here, import a data set. Right, and then you can see here, it is from Excel.
From where import in the
window 3? Window 3, second line, import a data set.
Okay. And from there, from Excel?
Okay. Aapki kaun si file hai?
Example1.csv hai, jo ki R course directory mein hai, within C drive. As in the example you had shown, you have got example1.csv file within R course directory and you use set wd command to just change the working directory.
Wait. I will just do it before you so that you can See here, now I'm just going to create here a new file before you. Yeah. Right, so you can see here, this is my data here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And in the second column, this is 10, 20, 30, and here 50, right? And so suppose, then I take here, say here 100, 200, 300, 400, 500. And I try to save this file as on the C drive. Yes, and I give it here a name as say Shalab. Shalab dot, and I want to save it as here CSV. Right, so now I have taken it here as a r.csv. Right. Now this file is there, and I will simply use the same command. Set wd. And I will first let me.
Screen is not visible, sir.
Wait, I'm just changing my screen. Now you can see I'm setting here, set WDR. And then whatever is the command which is given on the slide, this I will simply try to copy and I will simply try to do it here. For example, if I try to write down here, read.csv, and now within parenthesis, within double quotes, Shalab.csv. Right. Now working.
Say it has not to be stored in a variable as shown.
That you can do. Whatever you want, this I can give it. Let us say name as workshop, WS equal to this. Not this. So your your question was that you are trying to do something which is not working. So I have now shown you
I followed the same procedure.
I'm sure that means there can be some slips in the life.
Okay, I'll try it once.
It's working,
sir. Earlier one worked. Read dot table.
Don't worry, it will surely work. It might be possible that you are making some mistake in the double quotes or something in the dot or something like this.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Actually, you see, that was the difference between online and offline. Offline, I can always come to your seat and can see what are you doing. Means here it is something like you are, means I am asking the God and God is not visible to me.
That's true, sir.
So that's the constraint I have. I'm sorry for that, but I can't help it.
Oh, no, right. We all are facing the same problem, sir.
Yeah. I know. So, yeah. So anyway, so we have done this part. Right. So I would say that simply instead of going through here and there, once you are working, you simply try to use the MS Excel, and then you can do all these things very easily without any problem. That is much simpler, actually. Now I just want to give you some input and output things that when you are trying to do something, you want the outcome in a particular format. So that is what I want to show you with the couple of commands like a sprint, CAD, format, etc. That whenever you are getting an outcome, how you can control it. So can you see my slides? So if you see, there is a command here, PI, that is simply your here PI. And if you simply type here PI on the R console, it will give you here the value here, say 3.141593. But suppose you want to have here the say this 15 digits in the PI. So you have to first use here the command options, and inside parenthesis you simply write digits is equal to 15. And then after that, if you try to execute any command, that will have the number of digits to 15. You can see here 3, 36, 39, 312, and 315. All together, there are 15 values, 15 numbers. So that is how you can control. Suppose you are trying to do an analysis in which you want all the answers to be up to the in the fourth digit. So you can control these things from here also. And then there is another command here, say here cat. So cat, I will try to show you, I will try to give you more example. And but with cat, you can do the formatting also. For example, if you try to see here, I'm trying to write down here a command here, this one, backslash n within double quotes. Backslash n means new line. So whenever you are trying to do any analysis, your outcomes will be coming for each and every data set. And suppose you want to write the outcome on the next line, then you have to use this command backslash n. Right. Okay. And now, Miss, I can show you a better option of which is the what is the main difference between the print and cat, because you can see here the outcome of the say here print command and say here cat, here is the same thing. Sorry, py command and then printing of py, that is the same thing, which is not visible here. But now suppose you want to write it, the answer is you want to write, and then whatever is the answer of your solution you want to write, and then you want to store this outcome in a file. You don't want to see it on the screen, and you want that whenever I take the first data set, its computation is done, the outcome comes here, the answer is something, and then the next data set is chosen, and then the solution comes on the next line. So for that, I can write down here something like, say, cat. Whatever you want to write as a text, that has to become within the double quotes. Then you have to write whatever is the outcome of your program. And then you have to write down here backslash n. And then you have to write down here the file within the double quotes. And whatever file name you want to give, that is your choice. So this, don't use this file name, but this is your actually your choice. ABC, XYZ, whatever you want. And similarly, if you want to write the outcome in a CSV file, means a tabular data files format, then your command to save the file is write.csv. Write.csv, whatever is your outcome you want to write, what is the file in which you want to store the data files, and you whether you want to store the names of the row, because you know, sometimes in the data file, there is a row names also, like student number one, student two, student three, student four. So suppose you want to store the row names also. So this write command will help you in redirecting the outcome of a software outcome to a file in a particular format. Right. So this I gave you some idea. In the sense, my objective was extremely simple. That whenever you are trying to do the programming and whenever you want to redirect the outcome to a file, you can simply use these commands and can get it done very easily. Now I try to give you here some examples in which you can generate different types of data in the R. And these commands are very simple, but in my experience, they are very useful when you are trying to play with data science, in the sense that data science will have a data which is very, very huge. Suppose I can give you here one simple example. Suppose somebody has brought you the data and you want to add their first column in which you want to write all the numbers 1 to 100 as a serial number. So how to generate this number of 1 to 100 directly, or if you want to generate the numbers couple of times, 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, 4, how you can do it, or you want to generate the number 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, how can you do it? So that is my here objective. Right, so we have here a command rep. So rep is used to replicate the values in a vector. So now rep is used with here two options. Means if there is some values in the data vector X, so then I will write down here rep X, And then I have here two options, times and each. So times equal to and means repeat the entire values in the x data vector whole n times, well, completely n times. And each means repeat each value in the data vector x small n times. So what is the difference between the two? I can show you with this example here. Suppose if I try to say here repeat 3.5 times equal to 10, because see the outcome here, 3.5, 3.5, that is repeated 10 times. And when I'm trying to repeat here sequence 1, 2, 4, so you can see here, this is a sequence 1, 2, 3, 4. So this has to be repeated 2 times. So this I can write down here, 1, 2, 4 and comma 2. So here times is silent. So then you can see here 1, 2, 3, 4 and 1, 2, 3, 4. This is repeated 2 times, right? Similarly, if you try to take the times and each, I can take the same example and I can show you how it works. Suppose if I take here three numbers x, 1, 2, 3 like this, and I say here repeat x times equal to 3 and each equal to 3. So you can see here in the times 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, whole number is repeated 3 times. But when I'm trying to say here each is equal to 3, then each of the number is repeated 3 times. 1 repeated 3 times, 2 repeated 3 times, 3 repeated 3 times. So what you have to understand that what is the language of the R software in which R is working, so that according to your need, you can rearrange this these commands. Right, and similarly, if you try to see here, this rep command works on the numerical values, always on the categorical, on the alphabets also, like as characters. So for example, if I try to take here three values here, say apple, banana, cake, and suppose I say that, okay, times equal to 2. So, but definitely these values are characters, so they have to be given within the double quotes. And then if you try to see here, apple, banana, cake, this is repeated 3 times. So these types of things helps us a lot when we are trying to erase the data in the required format which the software needs. Because data science is not only static, data science should have an outcome which is easily understandable by the common person also. So these commands will help you actually in getting the right outcome in the right format. Similarly, you know that in the case of say Excel, sometimes you need to sort the data, means you want to increase, you want to arrange it in an increasing or decreasing order. So for that you have a command here, sort. You simply trying to say here decreasing is equal to false or decreasing is equal to true. So that will indicate that whether you want to arrange the data in the increasing order or in the decreasing order, as simple as that. For example, if you try to take here four values here, 8, 5, 7, 6, and if you try to write down here sort of y, so you can see here this is 5, 6, 7, 8, and if you try to write down here decreasing is equal to true, then it is in the reverse order, that 8, 7, 6, 5. So this is the same thing, same operation that you try to do in the MS Excel just by clicking on the button for say sorting. Right, so these are very simple operations. And one thing which is very important in the data science, that's a very simple concept about the missing values. Now you see, I ask you a very simple question, that what is really missing value? Missing value is something like the value has to be there, but it is somehow not there. So in this R, there is a process that we always try to indicate the missing value by capital and capital A. So whenever you get a data set, suppose you get a data set from somewhere which you want to analyze, the first step is to know whether there is any missing value or not. If the answer is yes, then the same commands are going to be modified, otherwise not. So in order to know whether a data set contains a missing value or not, we have a command here, is.na, is.na. So for example, if I take an example that I try to give here a value here NA. So that means X is actually NA. Now, if I try to say here is dot NAX, that means it is true. That means, yes, there is a missing value. Right. So now you have to think that how are you going to handle the missing value? I can show you here the very simple example that if I try to take here a data vector which has three values, 11, 13, and one value is missing, which has been indicated by here as a NA. So now I try to find out its mean. So it will give you here 11 plus NA plus 13 divided by 2 or 3, whatever you want to take. But it will give you here an outcome NA. So what do you want? You wanted here that I want to find out the arithmetic mean of the values which are present in the data vector after removing the missing value. Let the R compute the arithmetic mean. So if you want R to compute the required statistics after removing the missing values, then the command here is that you have to add here one more command, na.rm is equal to true. And believe me, unless and until you are interested in the missing values or their imputation, this should be a part of all your commands. Right. So now in this case, if you try to use this command on the same data set, the answer will come out to be here 12, because this is 11 plus 13 divided by 2, which is equal to here 2. Now in R, there are two words, NA and null, which are used to indicate that something is missing, but there is a difference between the two. The difference between the two is this. NA means this some value has to be there, and null means the value was not there in the data set. The difference I can explain you in a very simple example. Suppose in this workshop, suppose there are 100 participants, and the organizer decides to take an attendance, and suppose this roll number is 20, he or she is not present in the workshop, but he was selected in the workshop. The second situation can be 500 people had applied for this workshop and only 100 people have been collected, and those people who have not been collected, suppose one of the person among them is not present in the workshop. Now, do you understand the difference between the absence of the two types of candidate? The one candidate who was selected for the workshop, but he or she is absent, and say another candidate who was not selected in the workshop, but he or she is absent. So in the first case, this value should have been there because the candidate has been selected. So this is indicated by NA. And in the second case, the value was never the part of the data set because that candidate was not selected for the workshop. So whether he or she is absent or not, it doesn't make any difference. And that is indicated by here null. So be careful in the R. Sometimes you will get the value NA, sometimes you will get the value null. So you have to understand what are they trying to indicate, right? So now I will just take I will try to finish some part and then I will stop. Remaining I can continue tomorrow, right? So I'm just trying to compensate the loss which I made, and I'm sorry that you have to suffer because of my problem. So we have here logical operators. Logical operators means where it's something like greater than equal to, less than equal to, and exactly equal to, not equal to, negation, etc. Like if, for example, if I say here 2 is greater than 3, the answer is no, this is not true. But if I say 2 is less than 3, yes. So I'm not interested in the magnitude, but I'm interested only in the value, whether something is existing or not. So for that, so this, as I said, that true and false, they are the reserved words and they have to be used only as capital letters. And I will try to show you here some example that will, these things will make the things clear. So 8 greater than 7, it is true. 7 less than 5, it is false. Because this is the logical operator. Now suppose you want to test here, is 8 less than 6? I don't know, because means if you try to see when you are trying to play with the data science, the data is coming automatically.
For example, you have seen that if you go to Amazon or Myntra or somewhere, you try to browse some product, and if you don't purchase it after some time, you get a mail that, okay, I can give you 10% off on the trousers or on the salwar suit, etc. Do you think that somebody is looking for you? No, these things are automated. So what they try to do, they will try to seek the gender of the person. Based on that, they will try to send the promotions. For females, they may send for sari, salwar suit, etc. For other gents, they may send the advertisement for the trousers, pants, etc., trouser shirts for the male, etc. So there we need to know, based on certain computation, that, okay, whether I have to go for the option one, option two, or option three. So for that, this command will help you that is.true is true. You can see the structure, IS in small letter, TRU in capital letter, 8 less than 6. It's true, 8 less than 6, no, this is false. So this is here false. And now if this, I can do the programming. If the answer comes out to be false, then do this. If the answer comes out to be true, then do this. This thing. So that is where we try to use this one. Okay, so this is here, so you can see here, that is pretty simple. And similarly here, there are two operators here. Suppose if I want to join two statements, so they can be joined by either AND or say OR. OR means or, either this happened or this happened. So suppose if I want to join two statement by AND, so the symbol here is this double hypersign AND. So suppose if I try to take here the value here, x equal to 5, and if I write down here, x is less than 10 and x greater than 2, is it true or false? So 5 is less than 10 and 5 is greater than 2. So 5 is less than 10, yes. And 5 is greater than 2, yes. So yes and yes means true. And so we get here true. So these are the different type of logical operators which helps in us in taking different types of say decisions. And similarly, if you want to know or, means whether x is less than 10 or x is greater than 5, and suppose the value of the x is 5, so you can see here 5 is less than 10, yes. 5 is greater than 5, no. But yes or no means either of the two is correct, so the answer comes out to be here true. And similarly means that you can take thousands of examples and you can do it. But the more important part here is to understand that there are two logical operators, double and or, and how are you going to work with them. And believe me, this creates the magic. And telling you here, I am, means my motive is not to give you means about the R software, but if you go to my lectures on, I think some examples I have taken, but depending on your need, you can do the wonders using the concept of logical operators. That's my promise to you. And similarly, you can take more than one variables also. For example, I can take here two variables x and y, x equal to 10, y equal to 20, and I can check whether x is exactly equal to 10 and y is exactly equal to 20, right? Because equality is the mathematical equality, and double equality sign means the logical equality, right? So you can see here, x is equal to 10, y equal to 20. Yes, this is true. X is equal to 10 and y equal to 20. That is also true. So true and true is true, right? And similarly, if you try to take x equal to 10, yes, this is true. But y equal to 2, no, because y is 20. So this is false. So true and false is false. Right, so these are very simple things, means you can try with these examples here and you can do it. So I don't know, would you like to continue or could we stop?
Tomorrow,
yeah, sure. Yeah, I agree.
We can stop today. We can stop for the day now.
Yeah, I agree. It has been a long day.
So there is a very good comment for you. The moment you rush to your campus, somebody has written, Ms. Shikha Singh, she's from MIT University only. She's written that the greatest advantage is sitting at home. We are able to listen to you and learn from you, sir. Salute to your dedication.
Well, Shikha, let me tell you very honestly. Miss, I don't know the reason why I had to send my daughter to study in a private college, and then why she got selected into why I had to send her for PhD to US. Believe me, I mean, that is my very honest opinion. Means our universities and college system where we can get our sons and daughters to study practically for free. Right. Means I know I'm in the business. Many places, our own colleagues have stopped teaching. That is the truth. And to tell you the truth, when my daughter and nephew, means we had to get them admitted, means our option was then let's try to look into the private university. It's Manipal or say MIT. These were our choices. So I always, yes, I agree. These are the private universities. They are not getting any funding from the government. So they have to take care of their expenses. So the fees is going to be higher. But the good part is at least most of the people are working there. Why everybody wants their sons and daughters to come to only IIT? The only reason is that, yes, here I can see the difference that all of us, each one of us is very much dedicated towards the work. There is no concept of lockdown. Believe me, we have tried our best that this corona could not affect our study. Well, there is a compromise. I'm doing it online. There is always a difference between offline and online things, but we have tried our best to give it. So that's our simple dedication at our means in IITs, because of which we are surviving. So that's our actually habit. And if you ask me, when people say, okay, there was a lockdown, I could not work, I get badly irritated because if I look into my career, since lockdown, since last March till today, my output has been the maximum in the last 15 years. Because I was only at home, there is no phone call, no administration. Well, administration is there, but I will save my time going to office, etc. And then my production was very high as compared to when I have to go to my office. And then believe me, no work, whether there's a Senate meeting or a board meeting or anything, means the Board of Governors is the highest body of the IIT, which takes the all possible decision. Means I have attended, I am the member of BOG of IIT Kanpur, so I have attended all the meeting. They were on time. Means everything happened. So yeah, so that's our habit, I would say. But thanks, you at least you acknowledge our this bad habit, because our families.
Very good habit, sir.
But our families don't appreciate this thing.
Sir, we both are in the same profession, and I can't tell you what happens.
Let me accept it before all the audience. This is my first workshop in which I am teaching online. Up to now, I always said no. But somehow Anuradha could blackmail me emotionally. And then I was left with no option. But believe me, you can go to my homepage. You can see I have not conducted any workshop online. Yes, I have conducted, means I recorded the videos and we uploaded it. But this was the first time. So, but thank you, Anuradha. You had given me a courage. Yes, I can do it. Otherwise, I didn't knew. And so, yeah, I mean, say you all as participants, you will have to bear with me that. That you are my first victim of the online workshop. After that, I will get some experience, and I'm sure that tomorrow my performance will be far much better.
And we meet again in October. I have second advanced FDP. That you had also promised that yes, I will teach.
उस वक्त मैंने झूठ बोला था.
नहीं 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 मैंने नहीं सुना. मैंने सिर्फ ये सुना कि आपने हाँ बोला था.
But I am grateful to one of the participants who said yes sir, please go slowly, because yes, that was a very important part, because I am sitting alone in my room. There is nobody to listen to me, nobody to tell me whatever, whether I'm speaking slow, fast, anything. It's in the classroom, I can always do it. So at any point, if you are feeling facing any problem, please just stop me at that point itself. That will be a better option for me.
So see, you have attracted all the participants so much that it is now 5 past 5 and the session was till 4:30 and all are there in the class. That is the beauty of your teaching.
No, it's not teaching. It is means all are known to me. Means well, the only disadvantage of this online offline workshop is that I have to arrange my own water.
Yes.
And a cup of tea. Yeah. So that was the reason I preferred to stay at home rather than coming to office. That at least I can request my wife to give me. Yes, all these things. But anyway, so har ka quota hota hai. So you can't expect more from wives. I mean, do you agree? Mean expecting beyond that, it will be then.
He will only smile, sir. He will only smile.
Yeah, means kehte hai na ki shakal se dard
chalak jata hai. Chalak raha hai. So we'll meet at 9:30 tomorrow morning.
Sure. Okay. And means hopefully there should not be any problem. But now today we had a rehearsal also, that unfortunately if there is any mock drill. So a real mock drill happened, that if this happens tomorrow. Possibly is having.
Somebody has written ki Mishra ji, aap bahut smart hain. Very good comments I am receiving.
Nit, ye kaun se Mishra ji ke liye?
Praveen Mishra ji. Mere liye, maine video play kar diya tha aapka.
Actually, that's called management and that's called administration. Means at our place, as soon as we had this announcement for the lockdown kya hota hai pata bhi nahi tha, we were not used to offer this teaching online. Pura institute band ho gaya tha. There was no way I can even record my videos to teach the student. So if you go to my home page, possibly you will see that some homemade videos I cannot. So we did something. I asked my daughter to put my simple handycam at one place. So yeah, you have to do it. So I'm sure that one comment I don't agree with you with Anuradha. As a teacher, we have seen that if your students are not doing good, your motivation becomes half. But if your students are doing well, they are more interested, your motivation becomes double. So because the participants are good, that is why I have to stay here till 5 or 5:30. And I'm speaking for the last 5-6 hours, but still I have energy. So I am not a good teacher, but my participants are better than me. They are good participants.
Agreed, sir. Fully agreed.
So that is the correction to your statement.
So very good comments there are. I want to read each one, but it will take time. You please, we end the meeting so that you can have tea. It's
a long time since you are speaking.
Yeah,
right. So I will see you tomorrow. You, and then tomorrow I can share, means today now I will try to finalize my slides, although they are ready. But that depends on how I am going to do in the first, second lecture. One thing I would acknowledge before all of you. Whatever I have done today, it was very difficult for me to select what to do, what not to do, what slide to add, what slide not to add. Because I had, because I know the time limit also, and I know that once I exceed even a single minute, means everybody loses the control. So that is why I have very carefully chosen. These things are not complete, but still I would say you pick up a book, and then try to do and try to learn more. And then whenever you are trying to go into the data science, you will have a different requirements. Then based on that, you will have to search for the new topics in the R which you would like to entertain.
So as I said, I am not teaching you here the R, but I am simply trying to take out the fear from your heart. And as I said, some of you might face a problem when you are trying to copy and paste the command from the PDF file, because when you are trying to convert the PPT into the PDF file, which I have shared with all of you, sometimes some strange characters comes into the command. So there, if you are copying a command from my PDF file into your R or say RStudio, then be careful. Means just now it strike to me that lady, she was copying and pasting the command for the data MOSPI. One suggestion is that instead of pasting it directly on the R console, you try to paste it in the window number one, and then try to see that means something is there or not, because sometimes some strange characters come from after copying from the PDF file. For example, if there is a letter like double F will always give you a strange character. So I would say you simply try to copy from there and then try to just check, or you can copy and directly paste into the first notepad and then you try to bring it into the R software. Because whenever there is a line break, this PDF file will give a line break, but when I'm doing it from the PPT, that will not give me a line break. So that will create a problem, but I have no other option. I have shared in all my slides, that is a better option. Right. Chaliye Anuradha, then take care.
So sir. Okay, thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, all the participants. We'll meet tomorrow morning 9:30 sharp. Thank you so much.